The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, 9th chapter, text number 5, given by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded on the 24th of April, 1976, in Melbourne, Australia.
Last verse we discussed, Kṛṣṇa said, when he speaks Kṛṣṇa, you should understand Kṛṣṇa means God, the Supreme Being. Kṛṣṇa, the etymological meaning is the all-attract. Without being all-attractive, there is no meaning of God. It is not that God is attractive only to certain class of men. No. God is attractive for all classes of man, unless he is animal. Animal does not know what is God and what is the attraction of God. He does not know. But human being, in the human society, at least in the civilized human society, there is a certain idea of God. Either you follow Christianity or Vedic principle or Mohammedan religion or even Buddha religion, there is conception of God. There is an attempt to understand God. That is human society. Therefore, according to the capability or country and the people, the conception of God may be little different from one another, but the attraction for God is there. There is no doubt about it. God appears in three fundamental features. Brahmeti, Paramatmeti, Bhagavaniti sabhi. Vadanti tattavidas satyam jadyanam adyam brahmeti paramatmeti bhagavaniti sabdate. So, God is realized in three features by the transcendentalist. The first is impersonal Brahma. Impersonal Brahma without any particular form. That is called Brahma realization. Above that, there is Paramatma realized, localized. As Kṛṣṇa said in the previous verse, Maya tatamidam sarvam. Everywhere there is God. In the heart of everyone, even within the atom, there is God. This is called Paramatma feature. Localized, everywhere, God is there. And then Bhagavan. Bhagavan personal, the personality of God, the Supreme Personality of God. So, in the Supreme Personality, Kṛṣṇa said in the previous verse, Masthani sarva-bhūtāni na ca ahaṁ-atteṣu avasthitaḥ. That is explained in this verse, that everything is resting upon me. But at the same time, Nacha masthani bhutani, they are not also in me. This particular portion has to be understood. When Kṛṣṇa says, God says that everything is resting upon Him, that means everything is resting upon His expanded energy, not personally on Him. Personally is aloof. Therefore it is said, nacha masthani bhutani. The same example, just like when we say everything is resting on the sunshine, that does not mean everything is in the sun. But the sunshine is not different from the sun. Therefore you can say that expanded form, everything is resting on the sun. Try to understand this analogy. So, nothing can exist without God. Nothing is except God. But still, everything is not God. That has to be understood. This is called achinta bhidave tatra, simultaneously one and different. So the conclusion is the Mahavadi philosophy, impersonalists, they say that if God has expanded in everything, there is no particular personal existence of God. That is Mahavadi philosophy. But that is not the fact. Fact is, so although God is personal, He is person, just like you are person, I am person, He is person, but He is the supreme person. And everything is expanded by His energy. In another place, in the Vishnupura, it is explained very nicely that parasya brahmana shakti sarvidam ahilam jagat ego desa sthita shagne jyotsna vistarina jatha parasya brahmana shakti sarvidam ahilam jagat. It is very clear conceptual that the agni or the fire is situated in one place, but it has expanded by ekati-sastita-sarne jyotsna-vistarina. Jyotsna means illumination. Illumination has expanded. That is, we can understand if there is dark place and if there is a hard place in the dark. Immediately there is illumination, that is expanded. Similarly, God is situated in His own place, that is called Goloka Vrindavan. Goloka eva nivasati akhila atmabhut. That is God. Although He is situated in His own abode, which is called Goloka Vrindavan, He has expanded throughout the creation by His energy. This is explained. Eko desa sthita sarne. Agni, agni means fire. Fire may be situated in one place, but the illumination has expanded. Similarly, God is situated in His own place, but His energy, parasya brahmana shakti. So whatever you see, that is simply expansion of the energy of God. Parasya brahmana shakti. Sarvedam akhilam jagat. Akhilam jagat, whole universe, whatever you are saying. That is expansion of the energy. But the Mahavad philosophy, they cannot understand. They are less intelligent. Therefore they say, if God has expanded everywhere, then where is God person? No, that is not the fact. The fact is, God is person. He is situated in one place, His energy has expanded. Whatever you see in this material world or spiritual world, material world, the difference between material world and spiritual world means, in the material world we have forgotten Kṛṣṇa. Material means when we forget God, that is material. And when we know God, existence of God, then that is spiritual. There is a difference between material and spiritual. That is like this temple is spiritual because here there is no forgetfulness of God. Everyone, every moment, 24 hours, they are always remembering God. That will be spiritual. Need more. If you live in the temple, or if you live in God's business, Kṛṣṇa consciousness, there you are in the spiritual world. You are not in the material world. Material world means where God is forgotten. That is material world. So, God is expanded by His energy. Sarvidam akhilam jagat. The spiritual world means when His spiritual energy is expanded, that is spiritual world. And when His material energy is expanded, both of them are God energies. But in one energy, just like, I'll give you again the same example, the government, the government, say the university department, educational department, and the jail department. The jail department is also government department. It is not that government is absent from the jail department. Rather, government is spending more money for the jail department, more than the government spends on the university department. So both of them have government concern. But one department is full of criminals and one department is full of learned scholars. This is the difference. Try to understand. You don't think that material world is out of the control of God. It is also under the control, exactly. The jail department is also under the control of the government. So that is the difference, material world and spiritual world. Material world means full of criminals, all against God, all defying the authority of God. And the spiritual world, everyone is accepting the supremacy of God. That is material and spiritual. So here it is said, Natumasthani Bhutani, where God is forgotten, that is godlessness. Natumasthani Bhutani, Pashame Yogamaisaram. Although they are living within the kingdom of God, still they forgot. Because they wanted to forget. God is giving us facility that if you want to forget Him, He'll give it. Good facilities to forget Him forever. Jīja-sāmāṁ prapadyante sānta sayyo bhajāni aham. But if you want God, He'll give all facilities to come back to Him, back to God. So this is our position in the human form of life. If we want to go back to home, back to Godhead, then we can do that in this life. And if we want to forget Him again, we have got this chance. If we want to forget Kṛṣṇa, God, then we are again in the cycle of birth and death. That is the beginning of this ninth chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Asraddha-dhāna purusha dharma sāsa parantama apraktvamāna nivattanti mitru saṁsāra vartmani. Two things can you explain? Asraddha-dhāna, what Kṛṣṇa is speaking, the instruction, if we have no faith to believe Him, and if we don't accept it, then the result is that He is losing the chance. He got this human form of life to understand God. But if he is missing this opportunity, then the result will be apraptvamāna nivartanti. We have come from God. Either you go back to home, back to Godhead, or again we go back to the cycle of birth and death. Mṛtyu saṁsāra vartmani. The cycle of birth and death, it is called mṛtyu saṁsāra. Saṁsāra means tribulation. Tribulation, sufferings. The ultimate suffering is mṛtyu, death. So death, again birth, that is also suffering. Although we forget, but to take birth is a great suffering. Great suffering means you have to enter the womb of the mother and you have to grow your body, and there is risk of being killed also, especially at the present moment, that killing the child in the womb. So just imagine how much suffering it is. And if he is killed, if the child is killed, then his term of imprisonment in that body is not finished. Therefore, he has to enter again another body, again enter into the mother's womb. And it may be many hundreds of years may pass on before he can again see light. So this is great suffering. Therefore, Kṛṣṇa presents janma mṛtyu jarabhyādi dukkha dosānudasa. Intelligent person, they should all escape before the sufferings. We are making solution of our suffering for 10 years or 50 years or 100 years, because we cannot be here more than 100 years. So that is temporary. I am eternal, you are eternal. Our real suffering is to take birth and remain in the womb of the mother. And even coming out of the womb of the mother, the small children, they feel always uncomfortable, therefore they cry. The mother cannot understand what is the suffering of the... he is hungry, but the mother is thinking that he wants to sleep. Or misunderstanding, the child is uncomfortable. In this way childhood is passed, then again we become boy, again go to school, again examination, again this. In this way, the whole life is suffering. But under the spell of Maya, we are thinking we are happy. Therefore it is said, mṛttu samasāgavatmani. If we want to get relief from this business of birth, death, old age and disease, let us take to Kṛṣṇa consciousness or God consciousness and take His instruction directly and apply it in life, your life will be successful. This is the subject matter of this chapter. So, how God is situated, He is explaining. Natamasthane bhutane pasame yogamaisaram. Aisaram. Aisaram means supremacy. How supreme He is. Everything is resting on Him. Still, everything is without Him. And that is very easy to understand. That we cannot exist without God's mercy, without the potency on which this potency is life. Try to understand, what is this life? We have got this material body. Material body means this gross body is made of earth, water, air, fire, ether. This is the gross body. And the subtle body, mind, intelligence and ego. We are situated in this body. Therefore, what is this? These energies, it is Krishna's energy. Therefore, you are situated in the energy, material energy of the Supreme Lord. We are ourselves, also energy of the Supreme Lord, marginal energy. So, although you are situated in God's energy, we are forgiven. Therefore, Krishna says, Mastani Sarvabhutan. Everyone is existing on my energy. Still, I am not there. I am not there means the living entity has forgotten or cannot understand God, that He is within the God's energy. God's material power or energy, still He cannot understand. And another person, natamastani bhutani pasame yogam, bhutavit, natabhutasa, bhutavit. He is maintaining everyone. But that does not mean that He is one of them. He is also being maintained. That is a mistake. This is explained in the Vedic literature that nitya nityanam cetana cetanana ekajo bahunam vidadhatikam. Two kinds of living entities. Nitya nityanam. He, the Supreme Lord, is also eternal. We are also eternal. We are plural number and is similar number. Nitya nityanam. Cetana cetanana. Cetana means with consciousness. We are also conscious and Krishna is also conscious. So, He is the supreme conscious. And in another place it is stated in the Bhagavad Gita, khetragam cha imani vidhi sarva khetreshu bhāvat. There are khetragam. Khetra means his body. Khetra means his field. So, just like a cultivator works on the field and produces his food grain, result of tilling the field. Similarly, we have got a particular type of body, field, and I am the tiller of the field. Therefore, I am owner of the field. In India, of course, you have got a small plot of land, and each cultivator owns it and he produces his own fruit. Similarly, according to our body, we are producing the resultant action and we are enjoying the result. So, enjoying the result means in this body with creating some circumstances, and it is not possible to enjoy or suffer from the resultant action, then the next life we get another body, we suffer and enjoy. This is going. So the living entity is called Khetragga. Khetragga means one who knows his body. Every one of us, we know. I think it is my body. Nobody says I body. Everyone says my body, my finger, my hand. So therefore he is known as Kṛṣṇa, one who knows about his body. So Krishna says that Kṛṣṇa mani vidhi. I am proprietor of this body. You are proprietor of your body. But Krishna is proprietor of everybody. That is Krishna. Maya patamidam sarvam. He is in everyone's body. Ishara sarvutanam riddhesi arjuna tishtati. So, Krishna, that similar number, ekoja bahunam vidudhati kaman. So, that one similar number, supreme, conscious person, Krishna, he is maintaining the plural number. Therefore, here it is said, bhutavit nacha bhutasya mamātmā bhūta-bhāvana. So, whatever flourishing condition we are having in this body or in this life, that is also Krishna's mercy. We want Krishna, from Krishna we want something, either directly or indirectly. Even if we do not ask Him directly, indirectly I desire something. And Krishna is within yourself, myself. He understands that this particular living being is desiring something. So He gives you the facility of whatever you desire. But you do not know whatever you desire, that is the source of your suffering. But we do not accept Krishna's instruction that do not desire anymore. Sarva-dharmān parityajya māmikam saranam. He advised that if you desire, then you suffer. I will give you facility to fulfill your desire. But that you will get. But that is not good. You will suffer again. Bhutta-bhutta-praliyat. To fulfill your some desire. If this desire is not fulfilled in this life, then you have to accept another body. So another body means you have to enter the mother's womb with so much this and so much suffering. So long you desire, you will have to accept mrityu sanghara vartmani, one body after another, and to accept one body, living one body, that is very, very miserable condition. That you do not understand. But you should understand. Therefore, bhūtavit nacha bhūtasya mamātmā bhūta-bhāvana. So as the living entity is desiring, Krishna is giving him the facility. That is explained in another place in the Bhagavad Gita. Īśvara sarva-bhūtānām riddheṣe arjuna tiṣṭhati. Īśvara, the Supreme, He is everywhere. Māyātatavidam sarvam, we have already explained. So He is within the core of our heart. So whatever we desire, He understands. He is omnipotent, omniscient. He can immediately understand. Therefore, it should be understood there are two living entities. One is Paramatma and the other is the Jivatma. Jivatma. That is clearly explained in the Bhagavata. Khetra-gancha-vimāna-vidhi. In Upanishad also, there is a verse that the two birds are sitting in one tree. One bird is eating the fruit of the tree and the other bird is simply observing. The observing bird is Krishna or the Super Soul. And the eating bird is the individual soul. So, as he desires, that is, Ishara sarva-bhūtānām riddheṣe arjuna. He is sitting with me. He is so friendly that he is giving us guidance always. And he is waiting for the time when you shall give up your desires and surrender to the other bird, the observing bird. That is Krishna, Paramatma. Paramatma is so kind. that I am taking the body of human being, he is there. I am taking the body of an animal, he is there. I am taking the body of a demigod, he is there. He is so nice friend. He is always and giving me advice that why you are suffering in this way, creating your desires and suffering. Why you are doing this? Better you stop this, you surrender to me, come back to home, back to God. This is, he is always asking. So, Ishara Sarvabhutana Riddhese Arjuna Tishthati. He is staying in everyone's heart and he is omnipotent. He understands what I desire. So, Brahman Sarvabhutani Jantrarurani Maya. Because I am desiring something, because everything is not fulfilled by this body, therefore I have to accept. Suppose if I want to drink fresh blood, nowadays they are drinking fresh blood. So Kṛṣṇa says, all right, you get a body, a tiger's body, a lion's body, and you drink fresh blood. Why artificial? Just take the blood. If you have no discrimination to eat anything, so Kṛṣṇa gives us the body of a pig. You can eat anything. After soon, you can eat without any difficulty. So, or if you want to enjoy like a demigod, so he gives you the same body. This is going on. But this is either I get the body of a demigod or I get the body of a hog or pig or anything. It is suffering. Because I have to give up one body, that is suffering. I have to accept another body, that is janma mittu, jalabhyadi. And as soon as I get body, the disease and old age is there. Therefore, any type of body you get, just like in the Western countries, the Americans or Europeans, they think in India they are very happy. But actually, that is not the fact. Everyone is suffering. Anyone who has got this material body, he is suffering. Either he is in India or in Europe or heavenly planet or this planet. Abrahma bhuvana loka. Therefore Kṛṣṇa advises that even if you go to the planet known as Brahma loka, where the duration of life is very, very long and the facilities of living condition are far, far superior than here, so Kṛṣṇa says, even if you go to the Brahma loka, abrahma bhuvana loka, punaravarti nadma, madhis jadgatyanani vartante taddham. His advice is that you come to his place. Don't try to promote yourself in any other planet, just like they're trying to go to the moon planet. Similarly, somebody is trying to go to the heavenly planet or Brahma loka or Indra loka, Chandra loka. That you can go. Jati deva prata devan kitri indyan. You can go. But all of them are infected with the sufferings, namely the birth, death and old age and disease. So bhutavit naka bhutastha mamatma bhutabhavam. So God gives you chances. Whatever body you want, he does not prepare himself. But Jantra Rurani Maya, his agent is this Maya, material energy. And the material energy is conducted under his order. Maya Dhaksena Prakriti Suyate Sacharacharam. So, God, Kṛṣṇa, indicates the Super Soul who is situated within your heart. You desire something and he immediately orders the material nature that he give him such and such body, jantra. The body is jantra, machine. This body is a machine. So jantra rurani. He is seated in one kind of machine and he goes from one place to another, from one planet to another, from one life to another. This is going. Brahman sarvabhutani jantra rurani maya. So this business is going on. If we want to stop this business, and we have got this opportunity, human form of life, we can understand things if you have got little intellect. And everything is being explained by Kṛṣṇa. If we take Krishna's instruction and mold our life accordingly. That is the Krishna consciousness movement. Then our life becomes successful. And after giving up this body, we are no more going to accept any material body. Tatta dehaṁ punarjanma noiti māmeti kaṁtya. How we get a suitable body in which we can go back to home, back to Godhead. Madhyājino pijānti māṁ. So we have to work here. So we can prepare ourselves to being promoted to the higher priority system, or lower animal kingdom. We can become pig, we can become hog, we can become demigod, we can become so on, so on, whatever we desire. Krishna will give us opportunity. But that will not make us happy. If we go back to home, back to Godhead, without the tribulation of repetition of birth and death, that will make us happy. So our Krishna consciousness movement is giving opportunity to everyone how to go back to home, back to Godhead after giving up this body. One has to give up this body, that is certain. But why this body should be wasted for propensities like the animals? It should be fully utilized how to go back to home, back to God. This is our propaganda. And we base on these authorities of Bhagavad Gita as it is. It is not that we have manufactured it. There is no Kṛṣṇa manufacturing. It is authoritative. It is accepted by all the acharyas. So our request is that you also take this opportunity and be Kṛṣṇa conscious. And next life you go back to home, back to Godhead, and be eternally happy. Thank you.
Why
Krishna
hadn't come to the
West
until then? Why hadn't come
earlier? Because you are not born. After your birth you have come here. But to take you back to home, back to home. Now you take the opportunity, come with us. We are waiting for your birth.
How can one strengthen the spiritual will to act clean and live the spiritual life?
Spiritual life we are leading here, you can see. We are worshipping the deity. We are chanting Hare Krishna mantra. We haven't got to go to the factory early in the morning. This is spiritual life. Hare Krishna mantra, eat sumptuously Krishna prasadam and worship the deity. That is spiritual life.
Prabhupada, can one be in spiritual life without worshiping the deity?
Spiritual life means service to Krishna. So if you don't serve Krishna, where is spiritual life? That is the difference between material life and spiritual life. In the material life, you serve. But you don't serve Krishna. Or you serve Krishna indirectly, under pressure. But actually, when you serve Krishna, then you are situated in spiritual life. Mancambhyavicharini bhakti yogena jasayo chagunana samatita itana brahma bhuyayakana. So, spiritual life means to serve Krishna. Otherwise, material. Everyone is serving. That is material. Nobody can say that I am not serving. Everyone is serving. That I have repeatedly said. If he has nothing to serve, then he keeps a dog and serves him. So, service is my business. If I don't serve Krishna, that is material life. And when you serve Krishna, that is spiritual life.
I'm asking this question. I'm concerned about the perverted caste system in India today. I'm asking this question on the Brahman, the Vanashram Dharma system. If one of your Brahman initiated disciples falls from this platform, leaves the temple and commits offences, then returns demanding respect, should he be allowed to keep the sacred thread? Or should he be engaged in menial service, which never fails to cultivate humility?
Well, that is to be judged by the spiritual master. He cannot judge.
Well, I'm asking this because...
You cannot judge. He is falling, he is not falling.
I do not.
That is not your jurisdiction. Therefore, he has accepted the spiritual master, his jurisdiction. He'll do whatever necessary.
Has there been a case of...
That is case you cannot judge.
Yeah.
The case has to be judged by the spiritual master.
Did you give me an example of a case?
No, that's like if somebody has done something wrong, he is taken to the court and the judge gives his decision whether he is criminal or not. The man who has arrested him, he cannot be the judge. It has to be tried by the higher authorities, then the judgment will come. Anything? No.
Do they have deity worship in any other place in the human universe? Do they worship other than all these other planets?
Hmm?
Deity worship other planets?
Yes, every planet.